My name is Jakob. I'm a biologist. I have a master's in biology, and then I have a PhD in molecular biology. But I'm here today because back in Copenhagen, I started an insect farm with edible crickets. And I actually brought a few crickets today, which are on the table over here. And they may join the conversation at some point. And then I'm also co-founder of a company that produces juice with insects in them. In 2011, I read an article in the New Yorker that absolutely blew my mind. It was called Grub, and it explained how 2 billion people on the planet eat insects. At the time, I had no idea that you could eat an insect. But it turns out that it's actually only us in the Western Hemisphere that are lagging behind. And the article went on to suggest that we too start to eat insects, and it described how more and more people are starting to follow this advice. So why should we eat insects, you may ask? I know I asked that question. As a biologist, the topic of edible insects, it really piqued my interest. And as I continued to do research on them, I found that not only can you eat insects, it's actually also a pretty good idea. You see, we as a species, we're facing a severe food security crisis. It's becoming increasingly difficult to produce food enough for everyone on the planet. In fact, it's so severe that some experts are calling it the foodpocalypse. The United Nations estimate that there will be a rise in the demand for protein of 70% as we get closer to 2050. So this rise is largely fueled by a growing global population, but also, as people get wealthier, they prefer eating more protein. So why can't we just eat meat the way we're used to, just produce more meat as we used to do it? And here it turns out that the meat production industry is actually the primary contributor to many of the global environmental problems that we're facing today. It is, for instance, the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases. If you really want to do something good for the environment, it's better to stop eating beef than it is to stop traveling by car, train, bus, and airplane combined. Also, soon, 2/3 of the global population will live in areas that suffer from water shortages. And still, we spend more than 15,000 liters of water to produce just 1 kilo of beef. 15,000 liters. Maybe next time you have a steak, you can just for a second consider how much water went into producing that steak, how many thousands of liters of water. So if we want to avoid global warming and an array of other environmental issues, we have to do something different about the way we produce and consume protein. Okay, here comes the good news. Insects contain up to 70% protein. So kilo by kilo, that's more than beef or any other type of animal that that we're used to consuming. Also, instead of the 15,000 liters that it takes to produce a kilo of beef, it actually only takes 8 liters of water to produce a kilo of crickets. And in the process, you spend much less feed, and you emit 100 times less carbon dioxide. So insects are a fantastic alternative to the way we produce protein today. However, these dry data, they don't change the fact that we in Europe and in the United States, in the Western Hemisphere, we are confronting a huge cultural barrier when it comes to eating insects. Most people in Southeast Asia, in Central Africa, and in large parts of Latin America, they eat insects without a second thought. But us Westerners, We squirm at the thought of swallowing a mealworm or feeling the crunch of a cricket between our teeth. So if we want to push our food consumption habits in a positive direction, we have to break down this cultural barrier. And it's a challenge, luckily, that a growing number of people and of small businesses are choosing to take on. So for me personally, the first time that I tasted an insect, it was in the form of these freeze-dried crickets made in California. And they had this very strange cheddar cheese powder sprinkled on them. But mostly, I just found it incredibly difficult to take this entire animal and put it in my mouth and chew it and eat it. I too faced that cultural barrier. But at the time, I had spent so much energy talking about edible insects to my friends that I kind of just had to put on a straight face and eat it as if it was the easiest thing in the world. But then I actually tasted it, and I discovered this tastes quite good. I mean, they have a strong nutty flavor, and then they are packed with umami. So in the fall of 2015, armed with this knowledge of how great edible insects are, and reassured that they actually taste good, I volunteered at a place called Big Cricket Farms in Youngstown, Ohio. It's the only place in the United States that's certified to produce crickets for human consumption. And not only are they masters at producing the crickets, they're also at the forefront of the movement to motivate consumers to give edible insects a try. So Youngstown is a crazy place. It used to be one of the richest cities in America. It made its money off steel mills. Then, on one day in 1979, four steel mills went bankrupt, and soon more followed. Thousands upon thousands of people lost their job, and many fled the city to find new employment. Houses were abandoned, and the streets were left empty. Today, it's one of the poorest cities in America. So into this post-apocalyptic world came the founders of Big Cricket Farms. You see, the abandoned cities of the American Rust Belt, they're becoming fertile land for people that are still looking for the American dream. You know, maybe you have a huge art project. You can buy an abandoned house for cheap and use it as a studio. Or maybe you want to build a startup on a shoestring, like a big urban farm that produces edible crickets. Then you can do that. So it was in the confines of this incredibly inspiring city that I learned the craft of producing edible insects. I spent days in the stables hearing the insects sing the song of the crickets and watching them go through their different stages of life. You wouldn't know it, but it can actually be one of the most relaxing things to just see insects going about their daily business. It's true. So it was also here that I learned that you can produce 3 kilos of crickets per square meter per month, and that they are masterful small escape artists. One thing we would do quite often at the farm was that we would go to food fairs and festivals, and here we would serve insects. So we wanted to introduce insects to people, but equally important, we wanted to watch their reactions as we did so. And I quickly discovered that, just like it had been in my case, it's the first insect which is the most difficult one. It's there that the cultural barrier is strongest. So if we want to fight this cultural barrier, it's at the first insect that the battle is to be fought. We must motivate the Western consumer to dare to eat that first insect. Once that happens, then they will know that they actually taste good, and they will discover that they survived the experience and they actually live to tell about it. And soon, they will also want to eat more insects on a regular basis. So, however, currently, we just have to acknowledge that the cultural barrier is very strong. And we must respect that consumers in the West feel this way. I mean, that at least is our guiding star in Insekt Copenhagen. We must meet the consumers where they are, in their development, in their evolution towards eating insects. So two factors have proven particularly important when it comes to nudging consumers towards trying their first insect. One is to integrate them in already well-known products. In this way, you can turn the unknown into something known. So this can be as simple as adding a bit of cricket to snack bars or maybe to some pasta, or as we do, to juice products. And the second thing is to make sure that that people get a lot of information and education. That's particularly important. Once you know the many benefits of edible insects, you're also more prone to liking them. We live in a time where food and ethics must overlap. You can no longer just say, ask what a product does for you in the moment. You also have to ask, where does it come from? What was the environmental impact of its production? And once you're done with it, what will happen with it? And as this realization spreads, it becomes possible to reach consumers with stories of sustainability. I mean, it's well known, especially around these beautiful parts, that that you can make a wine taste better by talking about the southern slopes that the grapes have grown on, or the complexity of the terroir. In a similar fashion, you can now negotiate with consumers' taste buds with facts like how much carbon dioxide was released during production, or how little water was spent when you made the product. So the good news is that the insect revolution has started. Us being here today is evidence of that. Consumers are warming to the thoughts of trying insects. Media abounds with stories of how amazing they are. And we feel that less and less communication is necessary before people give them a try. Consumers are ready to take responsibility for their food and for how it's made. And often they even want to make it themselves. I imagine a future where there's an insect farm in every home. I mean, maybe like the one that we have here. There's a trend towards decentralization of our food supply. Why not make your own protein at home? You can feed the insects with the surplus fruits and vegetables, like, or maybe the leaves on the outside of a cauliflower, or the greens on top of a carrot. In that way, you also avoid food waste, and we can stop feeding animals with produce that we might as well just eat ourselves. And one of the most amazing things about crickets is the way you can change their flavor by modifying their feed. I think the closest I have ever been to a miracle was the first time that I cooked with crickets that had been fed basil. Now, there was not a shred of basil in the kitchen, yet when I blanched the crickets, there was the most intense smell of basil in the entire kitchen. And it was around Halloween, so it was almost a year ago to the date. And I made this very simple pasta with pumpkin and Parmesan cheese, salt, pepper, and then these basil-fed crickets. And it tasted exactly as if there was also basil in the dish. At Bugging Denmark, we are continuously developing new flavors. So we're making peanut and banana crickets, maybe for a nice dessert. We're doing licorice root crickets So maybe you know that Danes are completely obsessed with licorice, so we think that this one's going to be very popular. We are doing ginger crickets, maybe for some nice Asian food. And then we're also doing rosehip crickets, where we pick rosehip around the farm in Copenhagen and feed it to the crickets. Also, we're feeding them with apple pulp from our juice production. So by feeding them with something that would otherwise have been a waste product, we're making our cricket production even more sustainable. So in conclusion, let me just say that I believe that the story of edible insects will be a happy one. They are coming to a table near you. And they will help push our food consumption patterns in a more sustainable direction. In 5-10 years, it'll be completely normal to have insects on the menu in the cafes and restaurants. So instead of asking yourself whether you dare to eat an insect, maybe just ask yourself, what is your favorite flavor going to be? Thank you.